Welcome to the Rice Report, everybody. I'm Eric Rice. Thank you so much for coming back or being here for the first time. Really appreciate you being here. We got a lot to cover here, mostly financial. This episode is going to focus very much on the markets themselves and crime, which I consider to be part of politics since we are in an election season and we are dealing with maybe the craziest election in U.S. history. We've had a candidate swap out, another candidate with felony charges and an upcoming sentencing and all kinds of stuff. We're going to cover that a little bit later. But as we go through this episode, it's really important to really focus in on the markets themselves. I think the markets tell the story. I've been saying this for a very long time. And just to kind of reference this for everybody, these shows will get a heck of a lot more interesting after we get through the election. There's just so much to cover during the election. I want to make sure that everyone is an informed voter, that they are an informed potential retiree or just an up-and-coming, you know, young couple trying to save their money. You are under attack in every possible way. We are under attack in the food, the air, the water, the markets, the lies, the media. It's all a big thing. And I definitely will be getting a lot more intricate on some ancient history and some of the philosophical things that most people would consider conspiracy theories after the election. But my goal with this show has always been to keep it middle of the road. I can go real deep into some things, but I don't want to lose people. I think it's important to focus on, you know, the alligator closest to the boat, as my friend Timmy says. It's a saying that I love, that I will never not give him credit for. Timmy D introduced me to that saying, focus on the alligator closest to the boat and you'll always be successful. I think that that's a tremendous place to go. And unfortunately, the alligator closest to the boat is one of about 10,000 alligators in the water right now. And we'll work outward from there as a team, as a show, as a community, whatever we want to call this. But let's start focusing here on the markets, because I think that's really where most of the information from today is going to be a little bit unnerving for people who haven't followed the show. It's going to be a little bit celebratory for people who have, for who followed me for a few years. A lot of the stuff I've been talking about is coming to fruition. And I want to say today, you know, I'll just give a quick market update. The Dow was down 1.61, S&P 2.1, and the NASDAQ was down 0.97. Most of that is attributed to the Magnificent Seven, specifically NVIDIA. Now, I am not a stock market guy. The only thing I dive in and out of is the VIX. And that is hopefully all of you, I can't call it financial advice because I don't want to get in trouble, but hopefully all of you listen to what the VIX is, that you found ETFs that could trade the VIX, and then you placed some money in it because the VIX was up 38% today in the middle of this market crash. And that's how it works. It's the triple beam. So as the market crashes, more volatility is created. So you have a market crashing on one side and volatility jumping on the other. So if you want to know how to balance that without being a professional options trader, just owning the VIX outright or an ETF is a really good place to start. So you can capitalize on that downside in the market, upside in your own portfolio. But why did these markets crash? I think that's a big story. And two of these stories that are in here are things that we've been talking about in this group, with this show, whatever the heck we're doing here. We've been talking about this for a couple of years. So first and foremost, the PMI, the ISM PMI, so the Producer Manufacturing Index, which is basically an indicator. It's kind of like CPI, but for manufacturing. It's the best way to analyze. It doesn't have anything to do with inflation. It has to do with productivity. So the productivity levels in this country showed a significant and concrete leaning, if not a staple, of stagflation today. What we found out this morning, which is why the markets crashed, and before I go into this, I think it's important to note that America by itself really doesn't produce anything anymore. Obama had a lot to do with this. Obama was really proud of the fact that he was eliminating the manufacturing division of this nation, shipping everything overseas, pumping up NAFTA, all these other political choices that have led to American demise to this point in time are all coming full circle right now. You cannot have a fun and games liberal party and just do things that sound liberally good without being financially sound and expect the nation to actually hold on to its seatbelt as it goes through this volatility. So America doesn't produce anything. You can walk down any main street in any small town. Just do it. If you're in a small town, I'm right in a small town, Texas. I can go right into the next town, into a little downtown Main Street area. I've done this twice. You can go to a little boutique and ask the boutique owner, do you make the clothing in here? They'll say no. Well, look at the tags on the back of the shirts and the pants. They're all going to come from Taiwan and China. But this little boutique store should support them anyway because they're an American reseller. But America has just become exactly that. It has just become a reseller nation. we are the ultimate middleman. We'll finance something overseas, we'll bring it over here and sell it, but we don't actually want to get our hands dirty making it, which makes no sense that we are the most attacked climate change nation in the world. We actually don't have a whole lot of damaging manufacturing centers anymore. They've all been off put to overseas. So this manufacturing point, you can look at, go down that main street, you'll find a flower shop. Ask them where they get their flowers. About 80% of our flowers sold in American flower shops come from Colombia. It's their one of their largest legal exports. Of course, cocaine and drugs are a big export out of Colombia, but Colombia itself is a main exporter of flowers. Most of the flowers you buy in a flower shop for a funeral, wedding, your wife, whatever they may be, those are coming from a foreign nation. They're not grown here. The way that we do food in this country, which is a really important thing with RFK kind of joining Trump's ticket and talking about make America healthy again, that is such an important thing. I think people overlook the amount of microplastics, chemicals, preservatives, things that are in our food. But more importantly, I think people overlook the cost savings that Americans could have if we actually grew, uprooted or harvested, and then canned in our own nation. The way that this works after Obama is that essentially American corn growers, one of the largest corn growers in the world. I'm from the Midwest, so corn's just part of your normal diet. But corn by itself, the way it works in America is we grow the corn. About 60% of the corn is consumed by humans. 40% is consumed by cattle and for other things, for feed, pigs, things like that, to grow meat. But what happens with the corn that we eat when it's canned or frozen, to be honest with you, it gets shipped over to China or to another foreign nation so that they can can it and send it back, or they can freeze dry it and send it back. This creates, they say it reduces the cost of labor, but it increases the cost of shipping. What it ultimately does is it removes the bioenergy from our food. We want to eat food that is freshly killed or freshly picked. That is where you get the most bioenergy. My last business was all about understanding bioenergy. And the best way to say this is you can look at a squirrel. A squirrel eats, you know, a stalk of a vegetable straight from the ground. It's connected to the earth. It's full of bioenergy. So it's eating that straight there. And if a squirrel was the size of a human being, it would be able to jump over a building like a superhero. Super athletic, very lean. Then you have like a dog who eats the squirrel. It has to kill the squirrel. When something dies, it loses 60 to 70% of its bioenergy. These are really, really well-known quantum mechanics for vibration and frequency. So it loses that bioenergy. So the dog is consuming 30% of the bioenergy from the squirrel, who consumed 100% from the stalk of grass or whatever it ate. And then, of course, you know, if we eat the dog, bad example for the dog, but if we eat the dog, then we'd have to kill the dog and we'd be consuming less and less and less bioenergy. This is why the supplement industry is highly ineffective. Your average supplement in America today travels 1,900 miles before it actually gets to your shelf that you buy it from on the store, or if it arrives at your home when you order it online. The fact that we're shipping food all around the world to be treated by other places is actually kind of killing the entire American system. But it also shows you that we have very few manufacturing capabilities. We do very little actual work in this country. We are kind of the lazy generation, where most of the things that are produced in this country are sold overseas, and most of the things that are consumed in this country are produced overseas. This is really a big problem that's being exposed in the market today by the ISM PMI index number, which showed two really important things. Number one, prices paid for things went up. And at the same time, new orders went down, which means that inventories are now overstocked. There's more products being sold for higher dollar amounts while wages are rising and the cost of shipping is accelerating. This is by definition stagflation. So there's really no debate anymore. There's no soft landing. There's no nothing. Hyperinflation would be the next step from here. But we're in stagflation right now. When prices are rising, inventories are full. The good news is that with approaching supply chain issues, which are a very strong possibility, not a probability, but a possibility, that means that we have a lot of inventory sitting on the sidelines, sitting in warehouses. Warehouse space right now is jammed up. So if we look at this from the right perspective, we can train ourselves to understand that the market is in stagflation, meaning that hard assets will be very valuable, like I've been saying for 3 years. I'll reiterate my portfolio and I'll add the one thing to it that's changed. Gold, silver, Bitcoin, oil and gas investments with tax advantages, raw land, and the VIX. Those are the six things that I'm buying. You can do as you please. Those are the six things that I'm focused on. I really try to be micro-focused, laser-focused when I'm investing, because it means my family's future. It's not a game to me. It's something I try to win as often as possible in. And today was a good win. Today was a good day. But stagflation, this is nothing new. So the media is just now covering the fact that our manufacturing sector of this nation is now in big trouble. We have fewer orders coming in, more inventory being stocked up. The cost of that inventory is extremely expensive. Now you have to warehouse it. You have all these shipping expenses, and the cost of labor is going up because inflation is raging. This is by definition a real big, big problem. And the media just now covering this. I've been covering the PMI for 2 years, and I hope that all of you have followed along and paid attention, because you can make a tremendous amount of money understanding these things that are happening, even with small trades. But this is now the fifth month in a row that the PMI has dropped. Five consecutive months it's dropped, and the news is just now talking about it. And that includes all the news. CNBC, which actually for stock market news isn't a bad publication. They're all clowns. All the mainstream media, they're owned by the same six people that own everything. Six companies own all the media. That is absolutely a fact. And they don't want you to know, because we're the sheep that are being harvested for the slaughter. So they don't want you to know that these things are happening, which is why I get so many dings from YouTube for some of the comments I make. But I won't stop at it, because I'm not trying to sell you my opinion. I'm trying to give you facts. And I hope that ultimately you take those facts and you do something really great in your life with it. That's the entire point. Five consecutive months, and 21 out of 22 months, the PMI has dropped. The lack of manufacturing, the lack of vertical integration in this country is going to destroy us, because we're watching the ramifications play out. This has been dragging on, and it will drag on. There is no quick fix for this problem. There is no magic pill. There is no magic candidate. Only God himself could actually wave his hand and change what's happening in manufacturing in this country. We are looking at a decade-long rebuild period if we actually get the right people in office that can make those changes, so that we have American jobs once again producing American products. To me, that's very important. So the cost of shipping, combined with this drag on the economy through the manufacturer's index, or the manufacturer's sector of this economy, is creating the financial crisis. So we've been waiting for what the financial crisis is. The crisis is this. Our money is worth 30% less than it was in 2020. So every dollar is worth 70 cents. All of our hard assets are consumed and centralized and owned by major banks. So if you get your hands on them, get your hands on them. They're going to ensure that they win through this process. That is the entire goal. The banks, the central banks, the regional banks will probably get slaughtered, but the central banks and the national banks, their whole goal is that they don't care how much money you have. They never have. They never will. They take all you are is a lender to them. You give them, you deposit money in your checking account thinking it's staying there. They take leverage on it and lend it out to everybody in the world trying to make interest on it. Usury is a big problem. Always has been. It's a biblical problem. It is a very big biblical problem that we are living through right now. But if we look at this and you combine the stagflation environment, lack of manufacturing, lack of focus in this nation of actually building great things once again, all this nation knows how to do anymore is burn things down, not build things up. That must change for us to be a successful nation with generational wealth and generational comfort, if nothing else. But at the same time, our government is now paying $3 billion per day in interest cost. So the total cost of interest in Q2 of 2024 was $1.1 trillion. That's with a T. That's not a B or an M. That's a T, trillion dollars. And right now they're printing $9 billion. So they're printing $9 billion a day. A third of that goes directly into interest. Two-thirds of that is going into special interest overseas, Ukraine, Israel, everyone in the world except you. They are not doing a darn thing to save Americans. And that's what this episode, I hope, is going to really hammer home, because I'm really tired of hearing the old liberal line of we need people coming in this country so they can pick our fruit. It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever. We don't even have fruit trees. We don't even grow them. We import most of our fruit. So who's picking the fruit? But I'll get to that in a moment. So NVIDIA, who I've been talking about for about 6 months, I think NVIDIA is a big setup. I think it's a huge honeypot for investors in the end. It is absolutely a monopoly on microchips, absolute monopoly. And moreover, I think their accounting practices are gray at best. I think that's being kind, so I don't get kicked off YouTube. They're gray at best. They're very heavily accrual accounting. I'm going to have an episode here next month with a gentleman who's a businessman like me, and we're going to talk about the dangers of gray scale accounting, gray world accounting, how dangerous they can be for an uninformed investor. But NVIDIA just got served that they are being investigated for violation of antitrust laws. If you've been following this show, even just since I came back on YouTube, You will know that probably every three or four episodes I talk about antitrust laws being violated, and that the area of concern for me in this country has been the antitrust laws. The very interesting thing about this is it's happening in September during an election season. So NVIDIA today dropped 9% during the normal trading hours, another 2% after hours, and essentially dropped about $350 billion in market cap. That's the largest single loss of market cap in U.S. history. So we did it again, another record in America in the stock markets. Now, this isn't an isolated incident, nor is this a surprise. Eventually, in a clear-headed world, we would have this type of situation where an antitrust law would be investigated by our SEC and other governing boards for a company that's violating those antitrust laws. I will remind you that the bubble bursting in 2000 started when Microsoft was investigated for antitrust violations. NVIDIA has a much larger market share than Microsoft ever had in 2000, even more than they have today. And I think we're looking at the triggering event that's going to start a very slow and steady decline in the market, but it's going to have tremendous volatility. There will be big up days because it is an election and the system is manufactured and rigged. There is no way around that. And you know this, I can prove this. Uh-oh, I lost my signal here. Okay, part two. I don't know if anyone can see me here. I'll give everyone a few minutes. We're going to have to put these two together and edit them later tonight. All right, well, I'm going to keep going here. I'm going to keep going. I don't have the chat in here and our video cut off. We're having a lot of problems here. So NVIDIA, we were just talking about NVIDIA in the last part here, a violation of antitrust laws. That investigation began right at a time where essentially the market was kind of humming along right before an election. It doesn't make sense that they did the investigation before the election. So we are looking at a time where NVIDIA itself may end up being the triggering mechanism that ultimately ends up crashing the market because of the market cap loss today. So it was $1.1 trillion lost in the stock market today. About half of that was NVIDIA investors who, well, not half, about 40% of that was NVIDIA investors. This comes with TD Bank actually came out today and said that 30% of Americans are now cutting their expenses because they fear an economic downturn. So when you have an economic downturn that started out in the manufacturing center, it plays out ultimately into the entire semiconductor microchip space through NVIDIA, all the AI chips that are out there right now. This correlates directly with how difficult it is for an American. 30% of people are cutting expenses. There are now 454,000 Americans that are working two full-time jobs just to make ends meet. And in the middle of all this, don't worry. You guys don't have to worry at all about, you know, Nancy Pelosi, because she sold out of NVIDIA yesterday. So while the rest of us were stuck with, you know, a 10% loss in our investment in NVIDIA, if you own NVIDIA, Nancy Pelosi didn't lose a penny because she sold out yesterday. If this isn't the largest exposure of political corruption in the stock markets, I don't know what is. I mean, this could not be any more obvious that she sold out the day before an antitrust investigation was launched against the largest stock in the world. But it is losing momentum, though, because MicroStrategies with Michael Saylor is vastly approaching the returns of NVIDIA. And with their holdings of Bitcoin, I can see that continuing for quite some time. So along with these massive spending cuts that Americans are going through just to keep themselves afloat, we also have the breakdown. The last 3 years, there's a reason they don't include gas, groceries, and rent in the CPI anymore, because gas is up 35%, and that's actually down from where we were a year ago. Groceries are up 21%, and rent is up 22%. So all this stuff is happening at the exact same time that we are watching banks really sweat through commercial lending. Peter St. Ange did a very good video today, something we all already know if you're following this, but he did a really good job putting together the $1.2 trillion right now that's really in a tough spot for these regional banks holding on to commercial paper. When that commercial paper stops paying, and it will, especially after a 10-year-long work-at-home campaign where office space is essentially virtually useless or valueless, when they stop paying on those leases and the banks start getting defaults, we are going to see another attempted bailout. But again, I will reiterate this, bail-ins are the only option legally, despite the fact they bailed out Silicon Valley Bank and First Republic. The FDIC is running out of capital. They can actually only support about 2.1% of all deposits that are in banks right now. So if you had $100,000 and the bank collapsed and you got nothing but a stock certificate, the FDIC would only be able to give you about 2.2% of that money. So that security we once felt in banks should have left your body in 2008. But of course, they've done tremendous amounts of marketing and media to build you back up and get you back in the banks so that ultimately you find yourself in a position where you feel comfortable in the banks again. This is exactly how this is going to go down. This is not a random series of events. This is not an occurrence that's happening out of nowhere. This is a constructed demolition of the American markets and the American banking sector. And I'm not saying that to scare you. It's just the reality of what it is. If you read the doctrine written by our enemies, you know, you read about the New World Order and some of these other things, this is part of their plan, is to be able to have all these collapses at the same time so that Americans will give up their sovereignty in exchange for safety. This is an old, old tale, as old as any tyrant in the history of the world, dating back all the way to ancient Greece. Moving on. So along with this, the energy sector and some very strange sectors are being impacted. So if you were in on the VIX earlier today, the markets themselves lost 2%, NVIDIA lost 10%, you made 38%. Now, what's going to happen with the VIX moving forward, in my opinion, is you're going to see a cash out. A lot of people will take their original investment off and they will let their 38% run. I think it's a good strategy. But at the same time, I also think that we're going to see a lot of this cash in the market. There's almost $7 trillion in money market accounts. They're going to use that to pump the market back up tomorrow and Thursday and Friday. And in a couple of weeks again, I think you'll see another one of these, you know, drops in the roller coaster, or the ratchet system falling. And when that happens, you'll see another 38 or 40% pump in the VIX. So keep a little bit in there, because I'm not Rystradamus. I don't know the future. But as a trader for a very long time and looking at simple trades that are buy and hold trades without leverage or options, I think the VIX ownership is a smart place in these areas. But other areas that are interesting to me, this morning, Constellation, which happens to be, I think, the largest beverage brand or alcohol and spirits brand in the nation, they came out and prepared their investors for a $2.5 billion write-down for a loss of revenues, specifically in the high-end wine space. So I know that sounds odd, but when I first started managing money years ago, my business partner in that was a huge wine future buyer. So he would actually go out and buy a futures contract for a harvest of grapes before they were actually wine or put into a bottle or made into a product. And he made a ton of money doing it. I'm not advocating for wine futures. That's, you really need to be a wine person for that. But what I do think is a good idea is letting this run down. So while Americans don't have any money, while everyone's pinching pennies to save a few bucks here and there and be able to feed their kids, and we're looking at massive inflation rates everywhere, if you do have extra cash and you are a collector, buying some high-end wine in the next 2 months and storing it for a year or two is also not a bad investment. It's a hard asset. It's something that, as time goes by, it gets more precious, unlike most things that you'll buy from a consumer perspective. But more importantly, it's a great thing to have. Like if you're a wine person, I don't drink. I drink on New Year's. I shouldn't say that. I drink on New Year's. But I don't drink, used to be a drinker. And if I was still a drinker, I'm probably still going to stock up on some high-end wine. That's what you're going to see on sale. For the first time in a long time, you're going to see luxury items go on sale. That's going to happen in Q4. So if you're a Gucci purse buyer, I don't even know any of that stuff. But if you like high-end things, you're going to see the high-end brands really starting to take a turn, because all the retail money from the lower and middle class right now are already in a depression of sorts. The upper class is thriving. So while they're thriving, that consumer demand from the middle class, wanting to buy something in a class higher than their own, which is a normal thing for all of, we all want nice things. But in a market like this, where very few of the lower and middle class are going to be able to afford some of these high-end wines and these high-end luxury items that have resale value, that's actually not a bad investment at this point in time. Constellation is already looking at $2.5 billion in write-offs because the demand is so low for high-end wine right now. These are indicators. I've given you so many strange indicators that I look at. I look at the price of, you know, a Big Mac, how much income strippers are making, the production of cardboard boxes. There are so many different indicators of economic growth, peril, sideways action that you can look at. Fine wine is certainly one of those, as are luxury items like purses and leather goods. And these are now seeing lower demands, which means that the upper middle class doesn't have the money to buy those things anymore, which is a big indicator of things to come, because the entire middle class literally feeds the stock market. That's where all the discretionary spending comes from. Now, in the energy space, we are seeing mayhem in the energy space right now, and very few people are talking about this. So about a week ago, Libya decided that they were going to shut off all their oil fields, and they haven't really disclosed a legitimate purpose for this yet. However, they have made the announcement. And when countries make an announcement to shut down oil fields, they generally do. There's not a whole lot of bluffing in that game. We've seen that with OPEC and OPEC Plus and their reduction in production of oil. At the same time, crude prices are now at their lowest numbers since February of this year. So crude prices are right around the price just after the new year, all the way through February. OPEC Plus supply is the main issue why the prices are so low. But I think a big indicator right now comes from the Red Sea. It's astounding to me to see how many economists just completely ignore geopolitics, especially at a time like this. If you understand the political and the military environments of the world, you're going to make better decisions financially. And right now, the Houthis are attacking oil tankers specifically that are crossing the Red Sea. There were two of them hit by missiles in the last couple of days. One of them is still on fire. It's been on fire for 24 hours, and it's currently leaking into the Red Sea. They actually think that that oil spill, impending oil spill, will be larger than the Exxon Valdez in the 80s. If we see that type of activity in the Red Sea, not only is that a travesty for the environment, that is actually where oil does hurt the environment, because most of the time it's kind of a fairy tale. That's an area where it certainly does. There's no denying that. And that's a human error coming from a rocket launcher from a Yemen rebel hitting a ship or from another military boat. But the real effects of this are going to be that in order to clean up the oil spill, they're going to have to shut down those shipping lanes across the Red Sea. That's going to drive shipping prices even higher, pushing our production capabilities or manufacturing sector even lower, furthering stagflation in this country. Everything is interconnected. If you understand how it works, you can see the interconnectivity and just exactly how it's going to impact you and your life. Now, along with this, the EU announced today that for the first time in 2 years, they are buying more Russian gas than they are American gas. If you've been following me since 2022, when the Nord Stream 1 and 2 pipelines blew up, it didn't even take me 3 days to figure out who did it. We did it, or we did it in collaboration with the CIA and other organizations to blame it on Putin. Why Putin would ever blow up his own $2.5 billion a year revenue line into Germany makes no sense. But that was the mainstream media story. I said immediately it had to have been us to provoke a larger war. And so that we could, you know, essentially rape, so that the government or the mafia that runs the government could actually rape American producers and sell at a higher price in Europe. This is exactly what happened. We haven't determined who exactly from an official report, but when a criminal is asked to make their own official report on the crimes they've committed, you're never going to get the true story. And right now we have criminals that run this country in every single possible top tier category. And we're not going to get that true story for a couple of years. But there have been multiple articles and proofs that have been put out there that it was either us, the UK, or Ukraine, or all three of us working together to punish Putin, who is a nationalist, by the way. Really research people. I think he's being attacked for just wanting Russia to be left alone. It's my opinion, and I've spent 200 hours researching it. It's a very strong history. If you haven't watched the We're Pawns in a Much Larger video that I did maybe 2 weeks ago on the real story of World War II, you certainly should go back and watch that video, because it's got a lot of great information in it. And Tucker Carlson just had a historian talking about the exact same things. We're watching history repeat itself all over again. And in the middle of this is the natural gas industry. Now, natural gas has been so scarce in Europe that they actually called it a green energy 2 years ago so they could buy more of it without having to go through their own lunatic legislation and processes for green energy production over fossil fuels, also a fake term. However, the EU is now buying more natural gas from Russia than they are from America. So I've been telling you for a couple of weeks now that the most important financial report that will be put out this entire year is going to be the GDP report that comes out in October. That is right before the election. That is right as they probably a month after. I think they'll probably drop rates this month, but they'll probably drop rates. And then right after that, we'll get a really horrendous GDP because we no longer have this heist that's occurred. So what happened in 2022 when they blew up the pipelines, the price of natural gas skyrocketed in Europe. It got up to $30 a unit for natural gas, whereas here it was $2.50. So as that happened back then, and this, you can put this conspiracy together in your own head because I'll give you all the facts. You can do it on your own. So Nord Stream 1 and 2 blow up. They blow up. Now it restricts basically all the natural gas going into Germany and about 13 other European nations. While that's happening over the course of 2 months, we have a massive brand new liquid natural gas export center in Freeport, Texas, right in the Gulf, that would allow American producers to be able to send their own natural gas overseas for a massive profit. So an American producer could drill and produce, you know, $2.50 unit of natural gas, pay a fee at a port, have it shipped over to Europe, and then they could collect a check for, call it $20 for the same unit of gas. That would have made a lot of American oil and gas companies a lot of money. That didn't happen because the Freeport, which didn't even have gas going through it at the time, actually blew up. There was an explosion that happened there, cutting off the ability for American producers to actually sell their own liquid natural gas overseas. That's a fact. Now, most people don't know, I was in the industry, most people don't realize there's only four companies that actually do export of natural gas over to Europe. It's only four. They're basically in bed with the government, huge lobbyists. Half of them are owned by BlackRock, the other half by Vanguard. It's not a brand new story. This is the American monopolistic system that we live in. Those four companies made a killing. And since they're in direct partnership, either on the books or off the books with the government got to rake in all of that GDP and tell you that the economy was doing great despite the fact you couldn't put gas in your car or buy groceries. Well, that era is over. That era has ended, which tells me that their next rig of the GDP has to be war. Like I talked about in the last episode, you have an old fleet of planes, you give them to a foreign nation, you pay an American producer to make more planes, you get about 75% of what you had before for the same amount of money, which means you have to print more money to restock that and add some to the inventory for future giveaways. You know, America is kind of like Oprah Winfrey for foreign countries. You get a F-35, you get an F-35, but then we pay for it. So this rigging of the GDP for the last 4 years, I believe, comes to an end in October with that GDP report coming out. And that's right about the time where I think you'll see, just my guess, but I think you'll see probably a $50 to $60 VIX. I think that the volatility by that point in time, with rates dropping, the real fracturing of the economy starting to boil to the surface, market indices will start dumping a little bit. And I think that around that October period, you have a choice to either allocate into things that are counterproductive to buy and hold strategies like the VIX, or you can sit and pray, and I think that you'll end up being hurt pretty bad. So that's why I do these shows and try to share that information, because I think that now that the EU is officially stating that they're getting getting more gas from Russia than they are from America, that tells me that's an end to that shell game or that three card Monty that they've been playing with the GDP for literally 3.5 years now. So moving on, a couple things before we move on. International stuff, domestic. The trans shooter that shot up a Christian school in Nashville, must be 2 years ago now, they finally released more of the diary or the notebook that he, she, it, whatever, kept. This killer kept a notebook, and that's available to you online if you want to check it out. It's pretty disturbing. So if you're not trying to scare yourself today or make yourself angry, I'd advise not watching it. But we are starting to see this general boiling of hatred for Christians all throughout the world. That's not a new thing, by the way. You know, we've lost, I think last century, 140 million Christians were killed. You didn't hear anything about that. All you hear about is, you know, the poor people in the Middle East or Jewish people or whatever it is. But Christians have been attacked for a very long time. And that's amplifying right now, as we can see by the Immaculate Conception Church that just burned down in France. This church was built, beautiful Catholic church, gorgeous. It was built in 1859 and it was just burned down with a provable case of arson. That just happened. So staying in that part of the world for just a moment, Germany. Do a lot of talking about Germany lately, and I think that World War II is the most fascinating cover-up and story in the history of the world, and I don't really care who says that, because I'll be happy to have a conversation and certainly talk about it. But Germany is going through the same thing they went through their last three elections, the same things that we're going through right now. They just had a populist leader win an election. He was told that he won the election. Everyone in Saxony, Germany was told that he won the election. I actually have a friend whose mother was a baroness from Saxony. So I've heard tremendous stories about this place. But the next day, you know what happened? A computer glitch. And now they're reevaluating the election and putting in the next globalist puppet leader in Saxony, Germany. This stuff is not new. This stuff is worldwide. This is not an American problem. You're literally living through a communist takeover of the attempt of the world. And it's up to you and I to put our feet down and not comply with what they're saying to us. Like, you don't have to comply with the government. Actually, the government can only rotate on the consent of the governed. I do not consent to be governed by election systems that have computer glitches. Is all Germany needs to do and put their foot down and have them rerun their election. But that won't happen because people are too afraid. Now, the real estate market in this country, I'm a little bit all over the place because of our intercession here or our breakup on the videos. I did forget to cover one thing in real estate. They just came out today with a report that the average home is now 128 square feet smaller and $125,000 more expensive than it was 4 years ago. I did this report 2 years ago about the shrinking homes and the rising value, meaning you're getting far less for your money. I used to say that was actually a byproduct of inflation. It's not. That is certainly part of the problem, but this is more by design to build more urban areas. So smaller homes fit together with the 15-minute city theory and things like that. Now let's get into crime, because I think this is a topic that most people don't want to talk about and they don't really have the time to cover all of it. There's so much of it happening in this country right now. And there's so many stories that swirl around, and today's been pretty revelatory with some of the videos online and conversations I've had. But I think it's important to note that the New York Post came out with an article today stating that 75% of arrests that happen in Midtown Manhattan, that's Times Square, it's the part you always see on TV, 75% of the people arrested in Times Square right now, or Midtown Manhattan, are illegals. 60% of the arrests in Queens are illegals. So if you want to know how to reduce crime in this country, that equation is pretty simple. You get rid of people who are here illegally, who are criminals. They are here illegally. You get rid of them and you reduce crime by 75% in Midtown, 60% in Queens. That's just New York. The numbers from Chicago, from what I heard this morning, will come out in about 2 weeks. I think the numbers from Chicago are going to be much higher than that. I think the numbers from Los Angeles are going to be even higher than that. So pay attention to it. Aurora. I'm sure all of you, if you have a pair of eyes and a set of ears, you have heard something about what's going on in Aurora, Colorado, just outside of Denver. The reports coming from the news, from the mayor, and from everyone but the sheriff in that town is that Venezuelan street gangs, Tren del Agua, have taken over two, if not three, apartment complexes in that town. Now, I have never been to Aurora, Colorado. I have not been there recently to confirm this, but I do have friends that live there, and I do have people who I talk to frequently. And I can tell you that there is a massive Venezuelan gang problem in Aurora and all throughout Denver and all throughout Dallas and Chicago as well. However, there was a video, I forgot the guy's name because I really wanted to give him a shout out. I have it on Twitter. It's too long to screenshot for me. I was too busy today. But there was an investigative journalist, a YouTuber turned journalist, who actually went to Aurora, to the complex, saw the garbage stacked up, talked to people there. Thankfully, he speaks Spanish because almost everyone in the building does. It is absolutely true. Everyone in that building is from Venezuela, but everyone in that building denies that a gang has taken over the apartment complex, which, you know, we're in a psychological war. We're in an information war right now. And it's very easy to take, you know, most of our lives, we trusted the government, we trusted the news, and we could just, you know, until we heard it on the news, it wasn't real. It was just a conspiracy theory. Now, most of the things we hear on the news are the conspiracy theory, and the reality is right in front of our eyes. So this gentleman did a good job interviewing people who live at the apartment complex. They continually talked about all the gunfire that happens at night, how dangerous it is there. But all of them denied, every single person denied that Venezuelan street gangs were overrunning this apartment complex, which is going to cause the next topic of conversation where the left will say this is just a right-wing conspiracy theory. There's no illegal migrant crime problem in Aurora. And I disagree with that. Number one, there absolutely is a migrant crime problem in this country. But in Aurora, you have to listen to what people say. Listen, you know, my parents used to say, you have two ears, one mouth. Use your ears twice as much as your mouth. And if you don't just jump to a conclusion and listen to all these interviews of the patrons who live in this apartment complex, you will hear half of them saying, I can't say anything or it'll put my family in danger. So if you watch this from a black and white perspective, you would say there's no gang overrunning the apartment complex in Aurora. I watched it, and after I was done, I you know, lifted my head up from the screen and I said, this is absolutely happening. If you've ever been to a bad neighborhood and something bad happened and the police come, everyone in the neighborhood is trained not to say anything because you certainly, oh, there goes my video again. They definitely do not like me talking about this topic. I'm going to keep talking because that's just the way we're going to do this. We're going to finish the show out here on two recordings, not three. But if you look at this video for what it's worth, it certainly shows to me people are scared. Then you have the other part of the equation of people saying the Hell's Angels are absolutely going to Aurora. They're going to bail this out. You know, first of all, if we're in a position where criminal biker gangs are in charge of rescuing people throughout this entire nation, we're in really big trouble. The other thing to put into effect here is I know some people who've either are or have been bikers. And the one thing about that I've heard, was told from them is that unless somebody messed with one of their own, they wouldn't be there. So we'll see what happens, but I highly doubt that that's a real event. A lot of stuff gets pumped up across, you know, the internet and social media especially. But we are hearing reports of the same apartment takeover in Chicago, which all we have really are 911 calls that are pretty legitimate in my opinion. I've been making some calls that area of town. I don't have a whole lot of friends in there, and there's not a lot of people in Chicago willing to go there to actually give me a breakdown of whether or not that's real. Also hearing the same things that are happening here right off the George Bush Freeway in Dallas, another Venezuelan gang taking over an apartment complex. I don't know if they've taken over the apartment complex. I can't say that. I don't know that that's true. What I do know that's true is that the crime rate from these people is out of hand. And it doesn't matter whether they've officially taken over the apartment complex or whether they have, you know, simply just taken over the neighborhood and find themselves in a tremendously powerful position. It doesn't really matter. The logistics or the minutiae behind this is not the important thing. The important thing is that American families are terrified and that illegal aliens are taking over parts of cities. Whether they officially are collecting rent in an apartment building is unimportant. What is important is how terrified everyone was in that apartment complex to say anything. And by the way, almost all of them are from Venezuela. So if nothing else, they have taken over the apartment complex because only illegal Venezuelans live there. So put two and two together, it may be the landlord spreading a story about it because he's collecting big checks from the government to house these people. But all of them did say they were paying between $1,300 and $1,400 a month to live there. Now, Ricky Purcell is a rookie for the San Francisco 49ers. He was just shot and probably taken out for his entire rookie season by a 17-year-old gangbanger out of Tracy, California, who shot him trying to steal his Rolex watch right in the middle of San Francisco in broad daylight. So it isn't just the illegals creating crime in this country. It's also an emboldened youth who have no future. The mere fact that the kids in this country right now are resorting to stealing watches 60 miles away from their own home tells me a few things. It tells me, number one, that they really don't fear consequences for their actions. That's obvious. The other thing it tells me is they really don't see themselves having a future because they're committing heinous, violent crimes in broad daylight. And it tells me that the city of San Francisco is so well known for being soft on crime that gangbangers will drive 60 miles to commit a crime knowing absolutely nothing will happen to them there in that sanctuary city. These sanctuary cities need to be destroyed, eliminated, and completely rebooted with all new leadership. Now, moving into American and geopolitics here to wrap this up. And again, I apologize for my video feed cutting off. I don't know what happened, but we'll get it looked at here tomorrow for our next episode. Donald Trump was just denied being able to move his hush money trial into a federal court. And this is a big deal because the Supreme Court just basically granted immunity to people who were president of this country. And because he has this case, which they're deeming to be a personal case because it's personal hush money, they are denying him the basic ability to be heard in a federal court. That is a massively large problem and a violation of constitutional rights and the new rights instilled from the Supreme Court. This court case should have never happened. There are now three letters that are written and signed by Stormy Daniels that she never had an affair with him. Yet this man still has to go through these trials and be placed in avoiding federal courthouses to be able to hear his actual case. RFK, he is now suing the state of North Carolina to be removed from the ballot to be able to help Trump in the election. Presidential candidates should not have to sue a state to remove themselves. You should be able to be removed from a ballot anytime you like, because you watch what happens. You're going to see the bias in our system. You're going to see this horrifically one-sided legal and electoral system put into play in the next few weeks, I promise you. Is what you will see is RFK had to sue Michigan, Wisconsin, and now North Carolina to remove himself from the ballot. But Biden is still on three different states' ballots. Will the Biden administration have to sue to remove him for Harris? I highly doubt it. I guarantee these places are just going to kick him off the ballot and let Harris go right onto it. So pay attention to that. It's a great topic to bring up to those who are still asleep, who still believe that everything runs fairly. I'm going to guarantee that that happens in the next month, maybe month and a half, as the election gets closer. Biden is still on three different states' ballots for the U.S. presidential election. RFK is now suing states to remove himself, yet nothing is being done with Biden. So we will certainly see something happen with that probably in the next few weeks. Linda Sun, who is the former New York deputy chief of staff to the governor. She was just arrested under suspicion. Her indictment is sealed, so we don't actually know what she was arrested for. But the implications are her and the CCP interacted, stealing information or sharing information from high government level. You could jump to a million conclusions with this right now, but none of them will be deemed legitimate until they unseal the indictment. I do find it fascinating they're using a sealed indictment for this when they easily could make it an open indictment and let us know what she did. So when that's unsealed, we will know what she's accused of, but I think it's important that her home was raided and she was arrested today. Yesterday, the United States seized Maduro's plane from Venezuela. This is not a normal activity, seizing anyone's plane. At the same time, down in Venezuela, they put out an arrest warrant for Gonzalez, the guy who won the election only to have glitches in the system and a recount to lose the election to Maduro. He is now under an arrest warrant in his own nation for winning an election that was rigged and stolen from him. Sounds very familiar. Happened in Brazil, is now happening in Venezuela, happened in the United States. They're doing the exact same thing to this guy that they did to Trump. But the strange thing is they seized Maduro's plane. They are really trying to replace Maduro with a guy who's probably, you know, as Bill Cooper wrote, from time to time, the powers that be that run the world will use a populist leader. And Gonzalez seems to fit that mold. And now Maduro has put out an arrest warrant for his political opponent while the United States is trying to remove Maduro from power. Haven't had time to think through that or make any phone calls, but very strange situation there. The nation of Turkey, which I talk about quite a bit, massive military in the Middle East, nuclear capable, very large production scale manufacturing of arms and weapons. They've done two very interesting things in the last 10 days. Number one, they committed to $1 or $2.6 billion infrastructure investment in El Salvador for their two ports. One of those ports is the home of what Bukele is building in El Salvador, which he's calling Bitcoin City. So an entire area of El Salvador that just runs on Bitcoin. The largest investor in Bitcoin City through these ports is the nation of Turkey, who just applied and submitted their application to BRICS. BRICS is growing day by day by day, stronger and stronger. We are now sending long-range missiles to Ukraine. One who thinks logically never, ever would send long-range missiles to a country that only planned on defending itself and not attacking someone else. So we are watching in the middle of this while Putin offered peace. Zelensky didn't want it. Now Zelensky wants peace. Russia is not giving it to him. And we are finding ourselves in a standoff where we're now sending Ukraine long-range missiles because a war is necessary to cover up what's happening in the markets and the upcoming election, which I absolutely anticipate that we see some sort of cyber attack or grid attack in that process. Along with this, the UK is now testing their digital ID. This is the scariest possible environment from a financial and geopolitical standpoint. The banks and the UK government are cooperating with one another to build a digital ID infrastructure, which essentially will be a tracking mechanism for every citizen in the entire nation. And the UK will be the testing ground. It usually is the testing ground for the advanced nations. But if you're working with any of these companies, these are who's involved. Amazon Web Services, AWS, Barclays, Dun & Bradstreet, Ernst & Young, Experian, HSBC, Lloyds, MasterCard, Santander, and a handful of others that are primarily European companies. They are now essentially working together to implement a digital ID. The next step from a digital ID is a digital currency. So you have this mounting effort in the UK for mass migration. Less than half of the city of London is actually white and from London. They're all from Africa and the Middle East there. A lot of them from India. And now you have this populist, the population change based on migration. And now you're starting to see them enforcing more and more tyrannical laws, meaning that they are going to absolutely shove the digital ID down the throats of every person living in the UK. And in the midst of all this, the United States is demanding that that data is shared with us. So I know that a lot of times we think in terms of nations and people, but the reality is that every nation is under duress. They are being hijacked by darker forces who control at the very top. And these nations work together. They give the illusion of a rivalry or an ally or an enemy. But in reality, the leadership of those countries are working hand in hand, lock in step, in order to achieve a goal of essentially dominating the world from that shadow position. So there are shadow governments out there that are running everything, and it's being accelerated in the UK. So if you ever doubted the Second Amendment in America, it's the only thing keeping us away from having a digital ID shoved down our throat. Although we do have the FedNow program, where every intelligence agency in America can already peek into your bank account anytime they like without a warrant and see exactly what you're doing. So there is no privacy. We live in a security state right now, a surveillance state that cut off my video feed while I was talking about these important topics. Along with this, I'm going to wrap this up because the video is not working. I'll have to get this fixed tomorrow. Along with this, Mexico, who gets very little play in the general public when it comes to news. Generally, all you hear out of Mexico is that it's cartel run. That's true. However, the cartels are run by someone. We have dark overlords in this world. As it said in the Geneva Bible, we had worldly governors who do evil in high places. There's a specific reason they removed worldly governors from the Geneva Bible, to hide themselves. But these worldly governors, they operate and run every large corporation, every large nation around the world, and they now run Mexico because they recently, quote-unquote, elected a lady named Claudia Sheinbaum, who is of Jewish descent, who is now going to be the president of Mexico. And it makes no sense. She doesn't kind of fit the bill of the last presidents, but she is certainly a globalist and a World Economic Forum member. She was, quote unquote, elected to president of Mexico, and her policies are already being instigated in the country. She doesn't actually officially take over until October 1st, but you can see the globalist influence in Mexico that's already being put in place before she takes office, probably to be able to blame it on the other guy when it goes wrong. However, her two biggest policies just remind me of every other globalist lunatic around the world. The first thing she's doing, which begins tomorrow, is the nation of Mexico is using taxpayer money, which primarily comes from the cartels who pay the government the most money, but they are buying and renting buses to start shipping the illegals into America. So now, if you're an illegal coming into America, not only do you get, you know, $15,000 in Chicago a month to live on, food stamps, a cell phone, a free ride, a free place to stay, a beautiful hotel, you are now going to get bus shuttled all the way through the nation of Mexico, all the way to the border, where they will drop you off from a luxury liner. So that's already happening. That will begin tomorrow. So now these migrants coming to America to destroy this country, they don't even have to go through the Darien, well, they still have to go through the Darien Pass, but they don't have to go through the rough desert lands near the border, none of those rough areas. They're going to get a free ride from the nation of Mexico right to our border, be dropped off here. They'll come right into this country and continue to do what they've been doing since they got here. And the other policy she put in play, which I found really fascinating, is that she is focused in on right away. She said as soon as she gets into office, one of her main focuses for the nation of Mexico is to focus in on creating diversity, equity, and inclusion for the indigenous people of Mexico, including African Mexicans. That term I have never heard before in my life. I have never heard African. The only African I've ever heard is African American, which still doesn't make sense because not every black person came from Africa. That's just a fact. They may have come from somewhere else, but that's the term we've been given. So now Mexico is going to go through the same DEI woke culture shell shock that America went through. And I've got a strong feeling that it's not going to take as well in Mexico as it does in the United States. But we will see what happens, because it doesn't matter to me if their kids, you know, have to go through diversity, equity, inclusion training in their schools, because we have bigger problems from the buses full of illegals that they're going to be driving up to our border. So that said, I had a couple other things I wanted to go through tonight, but we don't have a video feed. I don't know how to fix it. We're going to have to kind of rewire this or update the software. Hopefully y'all have gotten something out of this evening. I apologize for the video cutting out on two different segments here today. But at least if nothing else, you didn't have to see my face this entire time. You got to hear my voice, which my face for radio came right into play. Maybe I broke the camera. It's probably me breaking the camera. But I apologize for that happening. Through all this, we have these churches burning down. I think there's been 88 churches in France that have burned down. They're going through the same thing we're going through. And at the end of the day, there's not a whole lot we can do about governments and stock markets and Mexican corruption and things that don't impact. What we can do is we can get really active in our local areas. We can really get to understand who runs our city council, our school boards, our election boards. This is stuff we can focus on and should focus on a regular basis. And more importantly, we can focus even further down the rabbit hole into our own homes and into our own hearts. So while these times may be trying and difficult for you, I think it's so important to be in prayer. Wake up in the morning, thank God that you woke up. When you go to bed at night, ask Him to give you beautiful rest. Get you through your difficult times. Throughout the day, just pop in and say hello. He's going to guide you in the right direction. I hope that some of this information I'm sharing with you guys is building a better life for you. That's all I hope for. That's all I wish for. But I do know at the end of the day that if we focus in on ourselves and our families and make those units strong, that's what God intended. That's how sovereignty is created. I don't need an outside party to tell me my family loves me and to tell them I love them. I think it's time that we really buckle down on that, really never give an inch to these globalists and the things that they're trying to do in our own lives, and really take a strong focus on God, family, and country in that exact order. And if we can do that, we can do anything in this country. So keep your heads up, keep your powder dry, keep your head on a swivel. Always make sure that you're paying attention to your surroundings. Things are getting very dangerous around this country. Have trust and faith in God. He's going to guide you through difficult times, protect you in dangerous times, and always lead you in the right direction. So until next time, I'm Eric Rice. This is The Rice Report. God bless you. God bless this nation. And we'll see you next time. Thank you so much.